Ignaz Semmelweis said to his fellow doctors that it would be a good idea if they washed their hands in antiseptic before delivering babies. It did not end well for Semmelweis. In this series, I'm showing examples of how powerful groups can often take over and stop good science progressing. Last week, we looked at Jay Bhattacharya, how he was mistreated by the scientific establishment. But there is actually a long history of scientists behaving badly, and sadly, it seems as though we haven't learnt from many of these mistakes. An example was Semmelweis. He was a Hungarian doctor and scientist and an early pioneer of antiseptics. His work, which was largely in Vienna, was on the occurrence of fatal infection in women shortly after childbirth. It was well known at a particular hospital that the two childbirth wards, that one of the wards had a far higher incidence of fatal infection than the other. Now, Semmelweis showed that the main reason for this was that the doctors of this ward where a lot of infections occurred, they were actually working in autopsies. So they were basically going from chopping up rotting corpses and then walking down the corridor and delivering a baby. And in those days, doctors did not wash their hands. So Semmelweis showed that simple washing of hands massively reduced the infection rate, which is not really very surprising. His data was unequivocal, but his work was not accepted by most of his colleagues or the general establishment around him. You can just imagine how those Vienna doctors just did not like what he had to say, and they would not look at his data. There would have been too many reputations that would have been dented. Imagine being one of those doctors that, due to their disgusting, unhygienic habits of going on working from cadavers to delivering babies, kill countless mothers and babies. They might have felt a little defensive. It is stated that they would claim, how could a gentleman's hands transmit disease? So for Semmelweis, it was devastating that he was largely ignored. He was seeing people dying around him, and he ended up getting bitter and twisted. He ended up having a breakdown and being put in a lunatic asylum where he was beaten up, and he died of gangrene from his wounds. So scientists who feel they might be being ignored by the consensus group, if you're out there and you feel like that, spare a thought for Semmelweis and smell the roses, because things could get a lot worse. Now, all this was terrible, but it's worthwhile comparing poor old Semmelweis with what happened to Joseph Lister, a British surgeon and scientist who was the man who really started the use of antiseptics in medicine, especially in surgery. So he sterilised wounds and surgical instruments and proved that microorganisms that caused the infection were floating around in the air. Lister built on the remarkable work of Louis Pasteur, who was the first to discover germs, microorganisms, and that they cause fermentation and putrefaction and many diseases. This was shortly after Semmelweis was doing his work. Now, before Lister, surgery was almost as likely to kill you from hideous infection as it was to save your life. Lister effectively invented modern surgery and is responsible literally for saving hundreds of millions of lives. Perhaps Lister's most groundbreaking work happened in 1865, the year of Semmelweis's death. So Lister certainly came against a fair bit of opposition to his ideas, as up to that stage, many medical people thought that infection just happened spontaneously. But in the end, he was one of the most famous and respected scientists of his time. He was created a baron by Queen Victoria and was given medals by the Prussians and the Danes. Lister deserved all the medals and all the honours, but it makes the fate of poor old Semmelweis all the sadder, I think. These are not just interesting stories. The question is, why does science sometimes work brilliantly, as it did with Lister, and sometimes so badly and broken? It's most important that we have the systems in place now that would make the Semmelweis experience less likely. But I'm afraid I think the answer is that I don't think we've put those systems in place. It's almost certain that in medicine today, there is a Semmelweis out there right now being completely ignored. Now, I say that because in the end, Semmelweis was mugged by groupthink and scientists who refused to contemplate the data. I think that's what happened to Jay Bhattacharya on the COVID experience. Now, maybe Semmelweis did not have the best powers of persuasion. Maybe he was a bit abrasive and he did not write very well or speak very well. But his data should have been followed up and it should have been checked. In order to stop groupthink, it is important that you have specific procedures to combat it. Humans are very groupy animals. We drift into groupthink almost automatically. So you need specific measures to counter it. For example, are the professional bodies constantly asking, are there dissenters who are being ignored? Who are they? And should we maybe look at their data and evidence again? The answer is that actually this almost never happens. Or if it does happen, it almost happens by accident rather than due to a system. But the drift to groupthink is almost guaranteed because of this system of peer review that is now ubiquitous in science. Peer review is where scientists cannot get their findings published until they are looked over by one of their peers, other scientists who are working in the field. Now, there's actually no better way of making groupthink. The group decides whether you can even publish your results. A dissenter will have trouble getting published right from the beginning. If he is questioning important scientists who have lots of influence in the scientific institutions, he could have a rough time getting any of his work accepted. And remember that peer review did not become ubiquitous until the last half a century, a little bit more maybe. For example, Lancet Journal, possibly medicine's most prestigious, did not start using peer review until 1976. The groupthink causing nature of peer review is probably worse now than in the distant past. There is nothing in the almost non-existent science quality assurance systems that we have today that would make one think that if Semmelweis was alive today, that he would have been treated any better. He may have been lucky, like Lister, and he may have been accepted, but there is little in the system that would give a great deal of confidence in that. Except one thing. Nowadays we have the internet and doctors can go around the authorities. Semmelweis could just post on the web his results and the word would start to get out. He would be labelled a crank for sure, a fringe scientist like poor old Jay Bhattacharya was. But enough people would look at the data and they would start to wonder. So the ability to communicate outside the channels controlled by the institutions is one of the biggest advances that we've had in science, at least in the systems of science, for decades. And that's something to celebrate, provided we can keep those lines of communications open. So what do you think? What would be the best way to prevent groupthink in science? And please like and subscribe.